In every form of creative expression, there's a spark of energy. An energy which can kindle a whole new style, a whole new approach. If the flame is fresh, exciting, and strong, it'll be passed on a torch from generation to generation. This is the story of a spark which became a gentle but a giant gleam. It's the story of Lester Young, one of the most creative and influential artists in American music.
The story ends here on Swing Street, on a lot which was once the Alvin Hotel. The Alvin was more than just a hotel. It was a community of musicians. My friend and idol, Lester Young, lived at the Alvin. It was the final home for the man we call the president of the tenor sax. The story begins where all jazz stories begin.
New Orleans, 1917. An ethnic melting pot, a unique phenomenon where Christianity met voodoo, where the French Quarter met Storyville, where white met black, met Creole. The energies of this multicultured city sometimes ignited fierce and even violent confrontations. But these same colliding energies also lit a fire under the town's musicians, and their jazz began burning up the streets. It had been 5 years since Willis Young brought his family to New Orleans from the Mississippi town of Woodville. Educated at Tuskegee Institute, Willis taught music to his entire family and to anyone else who could accept the demands of his teachings. While Willis was preparing the Young family musical ensemble for public performance, 8-year-old Lester would slip out into the New Orleans streets and absorb the exciting sounds of the Dixieland musicians. Between shoeshines, passing out handbills, and other means of earning a penny, little Lester was ever listening and ever learning. While jazz is said to have been born from a unique tradition, inheriting from Africa and borrowing from Europe, the music itself reflected both structure and freedom. Unfortunately for Lester, Willis wanted structure, and Lester wanted freedom.
Say, now, Lester, play your part. I couldn't read a motherfucking note. Get out.
His dad was very into music. He studied music himself and was a musician with carnivals, and he traveled a lot, you know, with other musicians. And then as the boys grew, you know, he taught them music. And he had this little band, and he just dragged the kids along, you know, instruments and all.
They played jazz and really any style of music their audience requested. Although the continuous travel was tiresome, the family band was refining their skills as musicians. Lester played mostly drums, along with trumpet, violin, and saxophone. Sister Irma was becoming an accomplished alto saxophonist. And even 3-year-old Lee was able to play more than one instrument. In 1920, the Young family had settled in Minneapolis, Minnesota. By the spring of 1922, Lester's musical interests took an interesting turn. At the age of 14, he found the drums cumbersome, mostly to his social activities.
Every time I'd be in a nice little place and meet me a nice little bitch, dig, her mother would say, "All right, Mary, come on. some drums. All other boys got no clarinet cases, trombone cases, trumpet cases. Yeah, I'm wiggling around with all this shit.
Enter the saxophone, a more social instrument as far as Lester was concerned.
Soon as I heard this bitch, I knew it was for me.
The Young family continued to tour, with the Twin Cities being their home base. While they toured, a new sound was being heard. It was a sound that pervaded from the state of Illinois and was labeled Chicago Dixieland. A group of white musicians led by a sizzling cornet player were the talk of the Windy City. Bix Beiderbecke was etching his style on the canvas of American music. It wasn't Beiderbecke, though, that caught Lester's ear. It was the sound of a 25-year-old sax player named Frankie Trumbauer, who played a tune called Singin' the Blues. He played the now extinct C melody saxophone, an instrument that produced a heavier sound than an alto, but a lighter sound than a tenor. From the moment Lester first heard Trumbauer, his ears would hear few others. In 1927, Lester decided to leave the family band to avoid touring the Deep South. He joined up with Art Bronson and the Bostonians. Lester continued to tour with the Bronson band until the Bostonians disbanded in 1930. He then headed back to the Twin Cities, where he lived with a woman named Beatrice in downtown Minneapolis. From 1930 until 1935, Lester gigged in the Twin Cities, besides stints with various other acts in different parts of the country. He joined the legendary Original Blue Devils in 1932 after co-leaders Ernie Williams and Buster Smith impressed Lester with something more than just their music. Buster Smith.
He bought that new Ford, brand new Ford. Went back there again. We weren't going to play. We just happened to be passing through there. And we went back there again, and we drove up in front of Lester's house there. He didn't live by the block from the place where they worked at. That Fire Point there, they called it. And he looked out there and seen it had that brand new Ford there, just tore the paper off and everything. That he went back to the house, got his horn, got his suitcase back, went on, left his wife too. Yeah, left his wife there, and the whole time he stayed there, he never did send for his wife.
Lester's life with the Blue Devils outlasted the Ford Roadsters, and he stuck with them until their demise in 1933. He then joined up with the legendary King Oliver, who was past his prime, but was to Lester a kindly old fellow. Also added to his resume in the early 30s was the Clarence Love Band and the Benny Moten Georgie Lee Band in Kansas City. Lester and his friend Herschel Evans would swap gigs, alternating between the Moten and Lee Band. It was with Moten that Lester probably met William Basie, although neither could recall their first meeting. Lester moved back to Minneapolis and married Bessie Cooper. Bess gave birth to a girl, Beverly.
My mother loved music. This is the way my father, you know, told me. Because I didn't know my mother. She died when I was just a baby. He really cared about my mother. He loved the both of us. And when he lost her, that really dug a hole in his heart.
It was more the rule than the exception that nightclubs such as the Apex in Minneapolis were being closed due to violation of prohibition laws.
I picked up the paper, got onto the streetcar, going downtown to play pool, looked at the headline, Chief Hart Raids Apex Club. I still remember those headlines indelibly written in my memory. And it struck me that this group would be unemployed. So I decided to go up and sign them to a contract, even though I did not have a place for them to play at the time. Though I did have a place in mind, the place that became the Cotton Club.
The Cotton Club's house band included Rook Gans, Adolphus Allsbrook, Popeye Booker, Bill Pugh, Boyd Atkins, and Harry Pettiford. Pettiford would soon be replaced by a man who at this time was gigging in Kansas City.
All the guys loved Lester, and they knew Lester and had worked with him. So we called Lester in Kansas City, and we sent him down a ticket. We picked him up at the station. Over and above his undeniable talent, his contribution to jazz. Was Lester as a man, as a person to me, was one of the gentlest, nicest human beings I'd ever met.
Corrales paid the group $126 per week. For his money, Corrales had something special.
The sounds that they made and the feeling that they produced had a great lyrical quality, as well as a driving quality, was also characteristic of Lester's style.
You could hear happiness or trying to be put a little comedy, or all of a sudden a little roughness in his music. Who knows what he was thinking about? Or maybe he spotted someone in the audience that he'd think something cute or funny. You'd hear it through his horn.
Lester played with a sizzling band. While the mostly white clientele was enthusiastic and appreciative, the magic of the Twin Cities band featuring Red Young would soon come to an end.
For one thing, there was no money to be made here. Very, very little. I mean, they seemed to do it just for the love of playing, you know. Because if you were working for trying to get rich, being a jazz musician, well, even to this day, it doesn't work, you know, unless you're already rich. But if you really love music, you stay with it. So he stayed here for as long as he possibly could, and then he really wanted to work with, you know, Mr. Basie.
So they sent me a ticket, and I went on that way.
Kansas City, the 1930s, a town notorious for being notorious. They had a mayor named Pendergast, a gangster who presided over a police force of which 15% had known criminal records. A wide open town? That's putting it mildly. Kansas City in the 30s was a roaring hotbed of corruption. Indeed, KC spelled sin. Sin meant money, and the undertakers were running the circus. Needless to say, Prohibition probably produced nothing more than a chuckle to the Pendergast regime as money gushed into the town. Jazz blossomed, and musicians migrated nationwide.
Everything happened to me there, as far as my career is concerned, with the band. Started right there. It's the most fascinating city, I believe, that I've ever been in.
Basie Orchestra could be heard nightly at KC's Reno Club. The performances were broadcast live. That's how a young talent scout discovered the Basie sound. The sound led him to Kansas City, and then to the tenor chair.
Fletcher Henderson had told me how wonderful Lester was when he heard him with Moulton's little band. So I gave Fletcher the money to bring Prez in because Coleman Hawkins had left. So Lester came up, best saxophone player I ever heard. I mean, the moment I heard him, I knew this was it, you know. I mean, in the first place, inventive completely and not an exhibitionist, everything I would have asked for in a saxophone player. And of course, he had a light sound.
Henderson snatched Lester up despite some resistance from Basie. Henderson offered Lester about five times his Basie salary. The money and the national exposure lured Lester to the Henderson band in March of 34.
But he didn't sound enough like a deep tenor like Coleman Hawkins. So the band said that they'd all quit if